Step number six, the design of the frequency response, also called frequency compensation. So, also here, we are going to design the frequency response, and we can do it in, we have techniques that we can do it in such a way that it doesn't influence performance aspects that we have to design at an earlier stage. So we don't have to recall things that we did before, and yet we don't have any reason to assume that we have a design loop. So what we are going to do is to design the frequency response and the action, the design aspect that we are going to do is, let's say, the pole zero pattern. We are going to correct it and we are going to use SLICAP as a tool. But in this demonstration, I will just do it with hand calculations because it's what I call simple enough. So frequency compensation. We correct the pole zero pattern of the uncompensated amplifier without affecting other performance aspects. And the most important is noise, energy storage, and power consumption. And the preferred method for do so for low interaction, as we have seen, we have some six techniques available. And the best techniques we have seen is the phantom zero compensation. That has almost no interaction with other design aspects. So for the active antenna, we are going to make a MFM characteristic with a phantom zero at the input of the amplifier. We have discussed in the previous lecture various techniques. We have also done phantom zero at the output of the amplifier. And maybe you recall that wasn't so effective. It was the best technique, the best opportunity that we had here was to do at the input of the amplifier. Phantom zero compensation. So here is the amplifier, not the small signal diagram, but the as we call the signal path diagram with assumed biased transistors and the idealized current mirror or the inverting current amplifier. Unity gain in the loop. And you see, we have decided to compensate this one with the phantom zero at the input. And this we have discussed before. This picture is from one of the previous presentations. So let's put the data together that we have until now from our design, from the small signal dynamic behavior. And then we have the circuit element values, the same as, of course, in the previous sheet. And the achievable MFM bandwidth, we calculated to be 1.5 gigahertz as the square root of the second order loop gain pulse product. And the sum of the poles, we didn't yet give you the numbers, but the sum of the poles is minus 450 megahertz in the simple representation as we have it here. So which means we don't have MFM because for MFM, the sum of the poles should be the square root of 2 times the bandwidth, which is 2.2 gigahertz about, or more. No, exactly, it's square root of 2, but we have 450 megahertz. So we can expect a lot of peaking and we need to have frequency correction. We can calculate the phantom zero because what we basically are going to do, we are increasing the coefficient that is setting the sum of the pole. So to 450 megahertz, we are increasing this coefficient in the, you could say, differential equation so that it becomes 2 gigahertz, which is the square root of 2 times 1.5 gigahertz. So it requires a phantom zero at 1 gigahertz and the value of the compensation resistor can be calculated from that, and we find it will be 30 ohm. I didn't include here a SLICAP verification of this. This, later on we will show that with this resistor and the complete result in LTSPICE that we have the correct results. But of course, we have presented this, and I think you have all the files with the asymptotic gain model, with the verification of this model and with the calculation of the phantom zero so that you can also do this for yourself for the differential pair. And as you know, there is not a big difference. The only thing is you replace this one with a anti-series stage and remove the inverting current follower.